Cupid, Cupid, you're a real mean guy.
She was the first female rock and roll star. Some called her the female Elvis. In fact, at the height of her popularity in the late 50s and early 60s, Connie Francis sold more records than Elvis Presley. Perhaps the only thing missing from a resume that includes the sale of more than 90 million records is a place in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Connie Francis's diehard fans have long been lobbying for her induction. One of her biggest fans is 90s rock star Chris Isaak, who has called her the best female vocalist ever to come out of America. Proof positive that her success in music has transcended generations. But despite her professional achievements, life has not been simple for Connie Francis. In the foreword from her autobiography, her friend Dick Clark writes, "Fame, fortune, and all those things we read about in stories and see in films became hers. Unfortunately, one thing kept eluding Connie, personal happiness."
Connie Francis embodied the innocent era of 1950s rock and roll. She was the girl next door who sang from the heart.
She had a crying quality, a poignant sound.
She had 16 top 10 hits and recorded in 15 languages, making her the biggest selling female singer of all time. But her father kept her cloistered and drove off the love of her life. But four failed marriages, an addiction to pills, and a brutal assault triggered an extended battle with mental illness.
As a performer, you have to leave your troubles behind. You're there to entertain the people.
Through it all, Connie Francis has been a survivor. Italian immigrants created their own self-contained neighborhoods in American cities, like the Ironbound section of Newark, New Jersey.
It was busy, it was crowded, houses one on top of the other, no lawns, you never saw a patch of grass. Lots of love, lot of family, lots of macaroni. We were raised very strict, actually. Our fathers kept very, very, very rigid control on us.
In the depths of the Depression, two average Italian Americans, George and Ida Francanero, had their first child. Concetta Rose Marie Francanero was born on December 12, 1938. George, however, didn't want children. He had left school in sixth grade to work in a factory and help support his family.
He had so many children in his house. You know, when you got eight kids, it's tight. So he never wanted children for that one reason. He said he never wanted to have to put his kids through like what they went through.
But Ida wanted children, and Connie came along. And when she did, I don't think George spoke to Ida for at least 3 months. He never looked at the baby.
In the evenings, George would play the accordion his father had brought over from Italy. Through music, he began to take an interest in his infant daughter.
And every night when I was a little girl, 2, 3 years old, I used to sit on the floor next to my father, and I used to listen to him play, and I loved every minute of it. And one day my father said to me, "Would you like to play take accordion lessons or piano lessons?" So I said, "Accordion lessons," like a dope.
Concetta accompanied her playing with song. At family parties and weddings, George would stand her on top of a table to play and sing. Connie had gained her father's approval.
Always playing. She used to practice that damn box until I couldn't stand it anymore. Do, 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 do. I said, "Go to bed." "No, I got one more song to learn." But my husband was so proud because she played, you know.
With a second addition to the family, George Jr., times were hard for the Francaneros. Many Italian-Americans were shut out during the World War II production boom. George pretended to be Irish to get work at the Newark Navy Yard. In 1949, television arrived in Newark, and with it, a host of local variety programs. George took Connie on expeditions across the river for auditions in Manhattan.
He would come off of a hot roof where he tarred all day long and save his pennies to get her lessons and carry this accordion. And people called him a jerk. "Where are you going? I mean, you know, nobody makes it. there's no money here, there's no connections here, you know, her chances of, but he believed.
Arthur Godfrey's Talent Scouts was one of the most popular shows in America. George took Connie to an audition for the Christmas Kids Only special.
Her name is Connie Franconero.
In her Coast to Coast debut, she sang Daddy's Little Girl. After the first night, Godfrey shortened her name to the Irish-sounding Connie Francis. Soon after, Connie became a regular on a local variety show. Developing physique made it hard to wear the accordion, which disappeared after 3 weeks. Connie received $25 a week to sing and appear in comedy skits. Like many Italian fathers of that era, George kept his daughter on a tight leash. In high school, Connie was barely allowed to date. She learned shorthand so her parents couldn't read her diary. She was not allowed to go to her high school prom. After 4 seasons, Star Time went off the air. The only work available for an unknown 14-year-old singer was cutting demo records. Publishers who wanted to hawk their songs would send these 45s to big-name singers. 45s recorded by nobodies like Connie Francis. Finally, somebody did take notice of one of Connie's demos. An MGM Records executive gave her a 10-single contract because her song, Freddie, would make a nice birthday gift for his son.
Freddy, my heart is filled with adoration. Freddy, you have a standing invitation. Come and sing love's old sweet song. You've stayed away for much too long. Freddy,
the novelty song only got airplay at the local merry-go-round. Then one day, two mobsters approached the Franconeros with a better offer.
There are 500,000 jukeboxes in the country and we own them all. We know we can make Connie a star. And it sounded all wonderful to me. But my father said, if she doesn't make it, we can live with that. But if she does make it, I want her to make it on her own.
Freddy, you used to think of me as being.
With only Connie's talent and her father's determination, they had 9 more singles to go on her MGM contract. In search of a hit song, she was about to join a circle of aspiring songwriters and meet the love of her life, much to her father's dismay.
Continues here on Biography.
In 1955, Connie Francis met a group of struggling young songwriters based in Manhattan's legendary Brill Building.
And we would all commiserate together, talk about how broke we were, pool all the money to buy cheeseburgers or club sandwiches, and they became superstars, most of the people of that period.
One of the Brill Building gang was an ambitious singer-songwriter named Bobby Darin. He brought Connie a song called My First Real Love. When they met in the studio, Connie disliked the brash Darin, but her feelings quickly changed. In the mid-50s, a man named Presley changed the music world forever. Connie and Bobby dreamed of being the king and queen of rock and roll and appearing on American Bandstand. They practiced dance moves and singing techniques, but getting time alone together was not easy.
And occasionally George Franconero, Connie's father, would show up with Connie, and Bobby wanted to spend some time alone with her, so I would go into the office and try to engage Mr. Franconero in small talk while Connie and Bobby could see each other privately in the other room for a couple of minutes. It was that kind of era.
Single after single, Connie's songs flopped, but her relationship with Bobby was getting more serious. At one point, he suggested they elope, but Connie was too afraid, and with good reason. When Bobby showed up backstage at one of her performances, George Francanero chased him out of the theater with a gun.
Bobby kind of put his foot down. He said, either you can go with me or you can listen to your father. And Connie was, quote, a good girl.
But I know one thing for sure, that throughout my life, there isn't any man I've ever met who could compete with Bobby in my eyes and in my heart.
Fresh from his success getting rid of Bobby Darin, George Francanero demanded Connie forget rock and roll and record a hit song from 1923.
I said, if I do that song on American Bandstand, the kids will laugh me right off the show. And my father said, sister, if you don't do that song, the only way you'll get on American Bandstand is if you sit on top of the television set.
Because she hated it, Connie, for the first time, sang without mimicking the style of a well-known singer. The single got airplay, but wasn't a hit. It looked like the 10th and final bomb. At least Connie could tell her father, I told you so. But on January 1st, 1958, while watching American Bandstand, Connie's entire life changed.
And I was practicing the dance steps, you know, with the kids, you know, the new dance steps they were doing. And then all of a sudden, Dick Clark said,
there's no doubt about it. She's headed for the number one spot.
I said, Daddy, they're playing Who's Sorry Now? He said, nah.
It's Connie Francis, and Who's Sorry Now?
Became a top 10 hit. It reminded adults of their own youth, and kids liked the slow dance beat. Connie's powerful voice even earned her comparisons to Judy Garland. Her follow-up single, I'm Sorry I Made You Cry, was an attempt to repeat Who's Sorry Now. It was too similar and barely made it to number 34. Connie needed a new, different song, or she might disappear as quickly as she rose to number one. She agreed to meet songwriters Howie Greenfield and Neil Sedaka.
I was very in awe of her. She came out and had her hair perfect and went to her home. And I was very timid.
Connie liked a rock and roll song they had thought was too silly for her.
And I remember there was a lot of glissandos, and I was so enthused and I was so into it that I was bleeding all over the piano. I cut one of my nails off doing these glissandos on the keyboard. And when I heard the final take, I knew that it was going to be a hit record.
Stupid Cupid, you're a real mean guy. I like to clip your wings, but you can't fly.
Stupid Cupid was her next top 10 hit. Before Connie, rock and roll had been the domain of men. Connie Francis was the first woman to rock with the boys and remain the girl next door.
You always knew that Connie never went all the way. So you never went all the way because you wanted to be like Connie Francis. And we all wanted to be Connie's friend.
Cupid, stop picking on me. Picking on me.
These kids were raised, Connie in Newark, Frankie and Fabian on the south side of Philadelphia. They were real people, and they dressed that way. They didn't move from their neighborhoods to grand mansions. They were not Beverly Hills 90210. They were real people.